Okay, but I do want to say to the workers, I missed some for about 4 weeks straight, not being in ministry and not being on the ministry. So we just want everybody to know that we're going to have our sessions where people can catch up and be under the teaching, because the things that we are teaching is very, very important. Very important. Father, today we thank you. We give you praise. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, for beginning the good work within us, and you who have begun the good work shall continue to perform it. We thank you, God, for every big good and every big perfect gift. We thank you, God, that you are working your will and the due of your good pleasure in us. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. All right. That's basically what I needed to say. And I want to give you a scripture. And the focus has been very heavily on our responsibility to fulfill the purpose that God has called us to fulfill. And I don't think that we can overemphasize it. And I think that many of you are really beginning to see the vision, you begin to see the importance of what we are striving to do. And we just want you to understand that the number one purpose that God has called you to, everybody, listen to me good, is that scripture says that the sojourn here on earth, the time and space that God has given us to live, is supposed to be lived in fear, lived in reverence, because God is He's monitoring our acts, our responses, and our works. The things that God is looking at is what we are doing during the time that He has allotted us upon the earth, what we are accomplishing. Everything that we are supposed to be accomplishing is supposed to be for His glory. Amen. And that's the purpose that God created us to, what, carry out His will and for us to finish the work that Jesus began to do. And when we fall short of that, then we are not actually living up to the purpose in which God has created us. We were created to glorify God. The Bible says that we are called, and we are that chosen generation. We are that chosen generation, that royal priesthood, and we are called to show forth the glory of Him. Everybody just said the glory of Him. That's the reason why we are called, to show forth the glory of Him who had called us from what? Darkness into light. That's the purpose that we are here. You know, I wish we as believers can actually realize the purpose that we were created. We were created to glorify God, to serve Him, to obey Him, and to carry out His purpose here on this earth. And there's a scripture which says that we've been bought with a price, and we're to glorify God in our bodies and in our spirits, which are God's. Amen. We're to glorify God in our spirits and in our bodies, which belongs to Him. How many believe that we are members of Christ? Temples of the Holy Ghost. God has no other way of accomplishing His will except through us. Angels can't do it. You know, the devil can't do it. And we, made in the image of God, are the only ones that can actually, amen, carry out God's purpose and God's will upon the earth. And the scripture says that, amen, it's God's will for His purpose to be made known and His healing knowledge to all nations. God really wants every one of us saved, amen, and come to the knowledge of the truth. And for that purpose, we are going to minister today on the reason behind all of the emphasis and focus that we've been placing on the ministry of reconciliation. And I'm just going to entitle this, What We Do as Believers. What we do and why we do it as believers in terms of souls. Why do we do what we do? Why is it so important for us to do what we do? Amen. Maybe that's a good title for it. Why is it so important for us to do what we are called to do? Amen. And I'm going to read you the scripture because I want you to understand the reason behind being concerned and being motivated by the Holy Spirit to do the works of Jesus and to carry out His will up on the earth. What's behind it, okay? This scripture, 2 Corinthians, I believe, 5:11, it says this. This is 2 Corinthians 5:11, and we're going to read down to verse 15. And we're going to read from, we're going to go down to 21. We'll just read that. It says, this knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are made manifest unto God, and our trust also are made manifest in your consciences. Okay, just notice that scripture. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and our trust also are made manifest in your consciences. Now that lets me know that there are some serious and grave consequences of not carrying out the will that God has called you to do. There are some very, very serious grave consequences. That's the reason why I'm really, although many of us have been in church for a long time, and I think that for the most part, many of us have really not understood and grasped the reasons why Christ tells us to do the things that He tells us to do. In other words, to fulfill our dispensation of the gospel. In other words, for us to take His place and do what He would do if He were here on the face of the earth. It's God's will for all men to be saved. Now, we need to understand that we are facing, consistently we're seeing the fulfillment of prophecy. And we know that the life that we know, the things that we are familiar with, and the lifestyles that we're leading are going to soon be completely interrupted. The end is upon us, the tsunamis, the hurricanes, and the earthquakes, the fires, the storms, and all of the things that's happened nationwide. By the way, we want to have a special prayer for the victims of the hurricane up in the northeast before we leave. And this shows that Jesus is soon to come. And when Jesus does come, you know, initially He's coming for His people. And that will be His first coming in the air, that He will translate us, or He will rapture us up. I mean, that is the church, everybody from Pentecost to the present age that's in the kingdom of God, that knows Jesus as Lord and Savior, that's been living for Him. He's coming to rapture them and to take them to heaven with Him, and there we will be judged. On the earth will be 7 years of tribulation, and it will be of such nature as the world has never experienced, even from the foundation of the world. It will never be anything that dramatic, that drastic, and that will be that consuming and agonizing. It's going to be a whole series of things. Now, some of you perhaps have heard a lot of the speculation about the year 2012, and a lot of things have been predicted in the year 2012. And we are not going to speculate on that, but there have been some notable things that have occurred already. Mm-hmm. And who knows whether God is thorough before this year is over. You don't know. But there are going to be some things that's going to be very, very difficult. For instance, it would be very difficult for us to stand up under what those people are standing up under. But out in the Northeast, in New Jersey, New York, it would be very, very difficult. But things could even be much worse than those that have just occurred. To me, that was even more severe than Katrina, in some respects. But things are going to get much graver. You know, it was about half a million or quarter of a million at least people that were destroyed in the tsunami over in the peninsula, over in the area where all of those people perished. And the Bible said when Jesus comes back to second time, the earthquake that will happen then, when his feet touch the tip of Mount Olive, he said that there will be an earthquake compared to no earthquake that have ever existed. And it's going to cause all the nations of the earth to fail, to fall. All nations of the earth are going to fall. And all these coastal cities, you better watch out. All over the world, coastal cities, you better watch that. Okay, but what I'm saying is that we know that there are going to be some grave consequences that we will have to face, especially if we, Bible says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? If we're negligent, if we don't do what God says to do, amen, if we don't live for God and carry out his will, you really don't have a whole lot to stand on. So what I'm telling you is that a sacrifice, make sacrifices. Amen. Come when you feel like it. Come when you're done. Right. And the Walter said that he works 20 hours a day. Amen. One day, 10 o'clock, he showed up in the Bible study. I know he was tired. He had his lovely wife with him. He was probably tired too. All right. So it's time to make sacrifices because the scripture says if we don't, if we suffer with them, we will what? Reign with them.
Yeah.
It's going to be 1,000 years that we're going to be reigning with Christ. And it's designed for overcomers. Yeah, look at that. Not people that just so soft and timid and jelly back and, you know. Some people don't want to suffer even do without a meal. Some people don't persevere even when they don't feel like coming to church. They just, you know, succumb to the feelings. I mean, compare that to the sufferings. The Bible says the sufferings of this world are not compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. It's given on the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but to what? Suffer for his sake. That's supposed to be the thing that really gets you together. Bible says that it's the thing that establishes us in faith. It's the thing that perfects us in God. The thing Jesus said he learned obedience through the things he suffered. I hear you, amen. Scripture says, endure what? Hardness as a what? Good soldier. This morning, Sister Hill probably was tempted to lay there because she just wasn't feeling up to it. She worked hard yesterday. Amen. Praise God. And amen. And kind of under the weather a little bit. And I tell you that sometimes you have to what? Persevere. And you have to what? Keep plugging. Because we know that the race is not given to the swift, neither the battle to the strong. But to him that what? Endure until the end. The scripture says we will be made partakers of Christ if we hold fast our confidence steadfast all the way to the end. All right, so here's the deal, is that during the millennium, amen, the rewards and blessings and the privileges, special privileges, are going to be relegated or bestowed upon those that were overcomers in this life. Now, let me just just read this. Some of y'all already know this. Revelation 21:9 says, "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." He that what? Overcometh. How many know what it means to overcome? Overcome the flesh. Overcome your feelings. Overcome your what? Overcome the devil. Overcome the world. Overcome your ways and the things you want to do. The Bible says, "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." That's Revelation 21. Now, I never knew that all of these special privileges during the millennium reign and even beyond the millennium reign, because we're going to do the same thing after the 1,000 years expires that we'll be doing the 1,000 years. We're going to be recommissioned. In other words, it's going to be what? Forever and ever forever. So whatever you will experience during the millennium reign, whatever responsibilities that you will be counted worthy to assume during the millennium reign, those responsibilities will extend over into eternity. Sobering thought, huh? Not going to be for 10. Okay, Revelation 21:9. "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." Okay. There's another, let me just write these down. This is not my message, but this is just a sad journey. Revelation 2:17, "To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name, written, which no man knoweth, save he that receiveth it." I don't know. I don't understand that fully, but it sounds good, and I want to be an overcomer. Amen. So I can eat off the hidden manna, and I want that white stone. And that white stone is going to be a new name written, which no man knoweth, save he that receiveth it. How many of them like to have that?
Amen.
Amen.
That, about 3 or 4. Okay. I understand why you're not interested in doing God's will. Revelation 2:26, it says, "And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father, and I will give him the morning star." That sounds like some really unique privileges and responsibilities as an overcomer. You know, the Bible does say we're going to reign with him. That means that we're going to be assuming responsibilities in the kingdom. This is the kingdom of God. Christ's kingdom. And, you know, remember the faithful servant. He says, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord." All right, he had an abundant, the faithful servant, the overcomer, everybody said the faithful servant, will have an abundant entry into the kingdom. That means that they will have what? The special honors and recognition, and they will have the privilege of hearing the master say, "Well done, thy what? Good and what?" How many believe it's important to be faithful?
Amen.
How many believe it's important to be consistent?
Amen.
How many believe it's important to obey God?
Amen.
Amen. I hear about 7 voices out there, seems like. All right. How many believe it's important to serve the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength?
Amen.
All right. How many believe that?
Amen.
All right. I have a lot of these scriptures about overcoming, but I'm not going to read them all, but in Bible studies I will give those out. But back to why we do what we are called to do as believers. Why is it important? Because we know that the terror of the Lord, we know that there are some grim consequences awaiting those who fail to carry out God's will and God's purpose for them upon the earth. Let me just enumerate the reasons why God placed you here. Number one, for fellowship purposes. God wants to fellowship. He wants children. That's the reason why he created us, because he wants children. He wants somebody that he can what? He can what? Relate to, commune with, love, and what? Provide care for. Amen. How many glad that you are a child of God?
Amen.
Amen. He could have chosen angels. He could have probably, had some degree of fulfillment with angels, but he wanted somebody that was created in his own image and in his own likeness. And that's the reason why we are specially, and the Bible, there's a saying that we said, we are God's, chosen generation. We are special people. We are the crown of creation. God hasn't made or created anything higher than what? Man. He placed man over all. Y'all hear me? Over all of the works of his hands. And he gave him what? Power and dominion. And placed all things under his feet. Man is a special species. We're here for a purpose because we're the only one that could fulfill the heart of God and carry out his will, and the only one that God could reveal himself through and convince men that he's a what? Loving, caring, wonderful Heavenly Father. He chose me. He chose you. He chose us. And we're not here to just to what? To have as much fun as you can. You're not here to play the harlot, well, for sure. I'm a light man, I'm picking it. You're here for what? Serious reasons. The Bible says that your life here, your work here, should be what? Lived or done in reverence. In reverence. Amen. Y'all remember last Sunday when I read those scriptures about Deuteronomy 10, 12 and 13? About what does the Lord require of you? I'm not going back into that, but one of these days y'all might consider that. Lord says the reason why I created you and what I require of you to fear me and to walk in all of my ways. Walk in all of my ways and keep all of my statutes and commandments and serve me with all of your heart. All of your what? Soul. All of your mind. With all of your strength.
Amen.
Obey and serve. That's the reason why you are you. And God created you to obey and serve. And when we fall short of that, then sin is what? Coming short of the glory of God. Coming short. Y'all don't hear me this morning, do you?
Amen.
Anybody sleeping? No. Coming short of the purpose that God has called you to. He created you to fellowship with him. Amen. How many like that? We can call him to fellowship.
Praise God.
I got a telephone in my bosom. And I can call him up from my heart. I don't have to go through a high priest. I don't have to go through what? No kind of animal sacrifices.
Right.
Is that right?
Yeah.
We are what? Living stones in the building.
Amen.
And we are what? Called to offer up spiritual sacrifices that's acceptable. You know, the only thing that's acceptable to God is the best you have.
Amen.
And I know some of y'all just pick a pattern around you. Try to play the Lord,
Jesus.
Not serious as a,
All right.
Amen.
Come on.
But the reason why I persuade men, the reason why I'm teaching like I'm teaching, the reason why I feel compelled to really motivate you to reach out to your loved ones.
Yes. Hallelujah.
There are a lot of people that perishing without knowledge. There are some people perishing because they don't know it. There are people perishing and they don't care. And there are people perishing and there's nothing they can do about it. And I believe the Bible says that we, the strong, ought to what? Bear the infirmity of the what? Weak. And not please ourselves.
Yes.
But the Bible said that we ought to please, we're called to please our neighbor. Neighbor is any person that's out there that needs our what? Help. We have to please our neighbor for his what? His edification. Jesus didn't please himself. Amen. Jesus had to what? Go through a whole lot. The Bible says that Jesus, he suffered the contradiction of the opposition of what? A whole lot of his enemies. I mean, he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And the scripture says, by his stripes, 39 stripes, he received 13 assassination attempts, beaten beyond recognition, till he was like a pile of ground beef, beyond recognition. And the Bible says that Jesus has already what? Suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should what? Follow his steps.
Hallelujah.
That means that we have to sacrifice some things.
Yes.
There's a price to be paid to obey God, to serve God. And God wants us to serve him acceptably, not just, amen, just throw up something at him. Amen. Praise God. He wants our motives to be right. He wants us not to be doing things for what? Self-glorification. To be seen. To please men. He wants us to what? To obey him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and what? Strength. And at the heart of the things that God has clearly said, because he calls us to fellowship. He wants us to what? Reflect his glory. In other words, he wants to be what? Seen or manifested. He wants to be what? Manifested through. How can the world know that God is a what? Is a good God.
Yes, hallelujah.
That he's touched with the feelings of our infirmities.
Hallelujah.
That he's full of compassion, slow to anger. How can the world know that? The only way the world can know is that there has to be what? Demonstrated and manifested through his children.
Yes.
That's the reason why we are so important to him. If God can't be manifested through us, then the world can't what? Know for sure what God is like. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. The world wants to know. Amen. People don't read the Bible to learn about the Lord, how good he is. Amen. Is that right? Most people don't read the Bible that don't know the Lord. Is that right? Did I tell them the truth? Amen. Because there's a whole lot of stuff you don't read the Bible. Not too much. Okay, so you know sinners are not people that don't know the Lord. They're not going to. Okay, now for the love of, okay, we know the terror of the Lord. We got that straight. Now we're going to jump down to 14. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge. See, the reason why the love of God constraineth us is because we know that we have to reproduce ourselves. In other words, we are supposed to be examples, and we are to what? Reproduce ourselves through what? Amen. Through ourselves. We have to reproduce. Amen. In other words, we are called to show forth the glory. People are going to be saved from the life we live, the example, and from the admonitions and the testimonials.
Amen.
have a gospel that we preach. Amen. And after we get them saved, then we got to what? We are called stewards of what? The mysteries of God. In other words, it's our responsibility to help people to grow, to develop, to stand, and actually to come to a point where they can what? Know God just like you know Him. And to please Him and to walk in all of His ways. Amen. How many know all of this is possible only through the grace of God? We can't do it in the power of our own what? Strength. Is that right? But the grace of God has been made what? Available. How many can say amen?
Amen.
How many glad that the grace of God has already appeared? We don't have no excuse. We can please God. We can get all the grace we need. That, amen. Just let God saves us by His grace, not by work. Then God keeps us by His what? Grace. Because He knows how to what? Establish. Amen. He said, amen. Unto Him that is able to keep us from falling.
Yes.
And to present us faultless before His presence with exceeding joy. Okay. Now, the love of God constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that He died for all, they that which live should not henceforth live unto themselves. All right, what does that mean to you? Y'all think about that for a minute. They that live shall not live unto themselves, but unto Him which died for them and what? Rose again. So that means that we are not to what? Please ourselves, but we are to be, the Bible says that we are to be, amen, able to live a life that will what? Be pleasing and acceptable to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise God. How many believe that we can live a life acceptable and pleasing unto God? Now, I want you to turn to the scripture here. Second Corinthians 4:3. These are conditions that constrain us to action. These are conditions that constrain us to action. All right? 2 Corinthians 4:3 says this, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Jesus Christ the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. All right, now, that is the primary reason why we must, and we are compelled, and we are constrained to carry the gospel and to share the gospel and to do all that we can to touch the lives and minister to those that the gospel has been hid from. Guess who has the gospel? Blind eyes. And keep people from what? Developing a desire or an interest, or he keeps them away or shielded from the gospel. Guess who is the guilty culprit? The Bible says is who? The God of this what?
World.
Who is the God of this world?
Satan.
All right, Satan is the God of this world. So that's the reason why we have to be aggressive, we have to be sincere, we have to be devout, we have to have passion. Y'all heard me tell a story about the minister that was administering the last rites of a criminal that was sentenced to be hung on a gallows. All right, this person was not saved. He was a criminal, and he was about to die and perish forever throughout eternity. Forever alienated and separated from God. The minister that was ministering his last rites was very casual. He was dry-eyed. He didn't have no passion, no feelings for the destiny and the fate of this person that was about to die. And immediately he would lift up his eyes in hell. And after hell, which he would stand for so many years, maybe the hundreds of years, he would be resurrected and then face the white throne judgment and then sentenced to the lake of fire. He was dry-eyed. He had no, actually, compassion. He was not moved with compassion. He was just doing his job without any emotional attachment. And this is what this criminal said. He said that if I were about to die, and if I were this minister, I mean, if I were this minister and I was doing the same thing that he's trying to do for me, he said, I would be willing to get on my knees and crawl all the way from the west coast to the east coast on my knees just to save one soul from hell. He said, I would be willing to crawl on my knees all the way from the west coast to the east coast just to save one person from hell. All right, so we can see that the sinner is in a desperate condition. He's blinded. He has no understanding. He does not automatically desire God or seek God, seek after God. And Romans 3 tells you the exact condition that the sinner finds himself. Okay, Romans 3, I just want you to just look at that. It says, there's none righteous, no, not one. This is Romans 3. I'll give you the exact verse in a minute. Romans 3, verses 10 through 19. Now, this is the thing that persuades us. This is the thing that actuates us. This is the thing that constrains us as believers. This is the reason why we've got to do it. And this is the reason why we speak to people to save their lives, by warming them. Amen. Praise God. This is the reason. How many know we are watchmen?
Yes.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
Let somebody say, I'm a watchman.
I'm a watchman.
And we need to watch each other. We're to watch. We're to watch out for people who has been blinded by Satan. They have been alienated and enemies in their minds by wicked works. And people that who the wrath of God is upon, and if they don't come to the knowledge of the truth, then they will miss out forever throughout eternity, and they will be what? Banished and alienated from God, and they will have to suffer the miserable fate of all those that don't face the Lord. Okay? Romans 3, and this is the motivation behind it. Okay, look at verse 10. There is none righteous, no, not one. See, this is people without the Lord. I mean, it's very critical. There's none that's righteous, no, not one. There's none that what? Understand it. There's none that what? Seeketh after God. They're all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There's none that doeth good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulchre, but their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There's no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all of the world may become guilty before God. In other words, there's nothing a sinner can do because of his predicament to change the condition that prevails in this life without receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And in order for him to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, he has to have somebody that will be willing to tell them what? The truth. And to share the gospel. That's the reason why the Apostle Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is what? The power of God unto what? Salvation unto everyone that what? Believes.
Amen.
Amen. So that is the reason why the condition of the sinner is so desperate, and the admonition and the command is so what? Is so imperative. Because that's the only way that what? The blinded by the God of this world can receive light to turn away from this darkness into what? Light.
Amen.
A testimony will do it. A call sometimes will do it. Building a relationship will do it. Inviting somebody to church will do it. But there's something that all of us need to be what? Doing in order to what? Amen. Cause sinners to place them in a position where they can what? Receive the word of God and turn from darkness into light. Now, let me show you how important it is. 1 Corinthians 6, 9, I don't have time, 1 Corinthians 6, 9, they said the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. So if a person continues to let the enemy blind them, deceive them, lead them, then Scripture says the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. That's 1 Corinthians 6, 9. All right, Romans 1:32, who knowing the judgment of God, they which commit such things are worthy of death. And there's a whole series of things that the wicked is consistently committing in the book of Romans 1. But there's good news that Jesus has come to seek and to save them that are lost. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, see, you have to remember that they who are committing things which are contrary, we have to still love them, reach out, pray, admonish them, be gentle, be patient, be loving, be kind, stay in the love of God. But we do know that who knowing the judgment of God, they which commit such things are worthy of what? Death. Not only commit those things, but have pleasure in them that do commit them. And that's the reason why it's worth making a sacrifice, what, stand on your face to help people. Because many people do not know the terror of the Lord. They do not know. So there's a judgment side of God, and then there's a what? A love side of God. Alright? Ephesians 5:5, it says that the unrighteous have no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Colossians 3:6, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Revelation 21:8 says, they shall have their part in the lake of fire that burns with what? That burns with fire and brimstone. And that's the reason why Ezekiel 33, it says that we are watchmen. Everybody say watchmen.
Watchmen.
All right, I remember a few years ago, I mean, Derek traveled that I-40. Remember when that whole stretch, that bridge, plunged into the Mississippi River? And all of those, Arkansas River, and all of those cars that were, amen, that were in that path, many of them ended up what? And it was many, many people perished because there was no watchman. In fact, they didn't have time to have a watchman or to put up a sign or to warn people that what? they were approaching what? Danger. So all we are what? Watchmen. When we know all of the things that God is saying about those that the enemy has blinded, he's deceived, the Bible said he comes to steal, kill, and what? Destroy. But I am come that they might have what?
Life.
Jesus is for us. The enemy is what? Against me. I don't want to serve somebody that's against me. The Bible says if God didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all? That's the reason why we are compelled to what? To speak out and to what? Act as a what? Watchman. And the scripture says that when we see judgment coming, when we see disaster, when we can see the destiny, that those that are without the Lord are going to what? Be facing and experiencing throughout eternity. The Bible says, speak to that person to save his life. Speak to him. Amen. I know people say, sometimes I call people up and pray for them. They say, well, I wasn't interested in being called out. I didn't want to be placed on Front Street.
All right.
But the Bible says that, hallelujah, amen, that we are to what? Speak to the person that don't know.
Yeah.
And warn him that what? There is what? Danger ahead. That's the reason why we do this.
Yes.
Withhold not good.
Yes.
Anybody heard that before?
Yes.
From them to whom it is due.
Yes.
When it's in the power of your hand.
Yes.
To do it.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And sometimes people want to know why we're always bugging them and harassing them, trying to compel them, push them, make them.
Yes.
I remember when I was trying to evade and I wanted to keep on doing my stuff. I love my pleasure. But the Bible says the pleasure of sin is just for our what? Season. And when one, after this is all over,
come on.
We're going to have to what? Stand before God. Believers stand before the judgment seat to see if you will merit any kind of reward. The ungodly will stand before the white throne.
Come on.
And they will have to give an account of their life.
Yeah.
But their final destiny, regardless of what they say, is going to be what? They're going to be cast into the lake of fire. I think it's kind of hard for people to go to hell without warning, because the Bible says warning always comes before what? Destruction and a hard spirit before a fall. And most, you know, I mean, we're the one that's supposed to be sounding the trumpet, sounding the alarm. Danger!
Yes!
Speak about our warning.
Come on!
Derek Nim had just made it over that part that failed about 30 minutes prior to the time that the thing collapsed.
Oh, glory!
Yes.
Don't hate us, because the Bible says that we're to what? Warn people.
Yes.
In warning people and letting them know, then that means that they, if they don't heed, then they will what? They would have heard.
Come on.
They have had a chance to what? Accept or reject, and the blood, amen, will not be what? On my hand, but it will be what? On theirs.
That's right.
That's the reason we said, danger ahead. Danger ahead. Amen. They were one up in Northeast before that hurricane struck. They were saying what? Danger ahead. And what did they do? They start what? Making provisions to get out of the path, or to what? Escape, or to get to a place where he would be what? Saved. Suppose they had not heeded the warning.
Yep.
Some of them didn't, but it was just a small number that perished. Suppose the millions that fled had heeded. Rather than just 100 or so perishing, it would have been what? Millions.
That's right.
Yes. Glory to God.
So it's kind of important for you to what? Kind of heed.
Yes.
The what? The warning. And it's really important for you to what? You to what? Sound the trumpet.
Come on.
And do the warning.
Yes.
Glory. How many can say amen?
Amen.
That's the reason why it's so important for us as believers to really, really think about the souls. The Bible says they who do not turn to Christ and to live for Christ and obey and serve Him, the Bible says this, that the wrath of God is going to what? They're going to be upon the wrath of God. They will not inherit what? The kingdom of God. They will not inherit the kingdom of Christ. They will not be overcomers. The Bible says, and they will not make heaven, for the Bible says they will be alienated and separated from God throughout eternity in the lake of fire. Amen. But Jesus has come to what? That we might have life.
Yes, hallelujah.
Why did He go through all of the suffering? The Bible says He was wounded for our transgression. And He was what? Bruised for our iniquity. Jesus had to pay an awesome price.
Yes.
How many know that after Jesus hung on the cross and all of the humiliation, all of the agony and pain, and all of the harmful things that they did to Him physically, after that, Jesus had to what? Go and pay the price spiritually. In other words, His spirit suffered underneath. That's where everybody's spirits go when they die. When their spirits and bodies separate, their spirits go down beneath the earth. Either in hell, or for the lost. And people who were saved, their spirits what? They go with Christ. And how many can say amen? Your spirit go up to paradise. How many glad you don't go down no more? Everybody used to go down. But Jesus what? Cleared, amen, paradise down that was underneath the earth. And He what? He brought everybody that was what? Down there, what? Out. And they are what? Ascended. And they are now in paradise. And when we die, go to be with the Lord, our spirits go to heaven. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. But Jesus went to hell and He suffered in His spirit. The agony and the pain. Whatever a sinner suffers through, amen, for hundreds of years, everybody's going to suffer until Jesus, amen, comes back the second time, amen, after the 1,000, amen, praise, years of the millennium is over. Everybody is going to go what? Going to rise again as unsaved, and they're going to stand before the white throne judgment. That's a long time to be in hell. Spirit and soul, what? In torment.
Yes.
But Jesus has already, what? Paid the price. How many can say amen?
Amen.
The Bible says, for God so, what? Loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. It's not God's will that any would perish. And He wants all of us to, what? Come to, what? How many know that Jesus has paid the price?
Amen.
And it's a matter of us, what? Taking Him as what? Lord and Savior.
Yes.
And that's all that God is looking for a person that's without Him to do. Jesus has already paid the price. He's already suffered and rose again. When we can accept Him as Lord and Savior, believe in our hearts that God raised Him from the dead, the Bible says, thou shalt be what? Saved. Amen. How many want to see? How many want to see sinners saved? How many know that Jesus paid an awful price for them? How many know that he committed his love toward them while we were yet in sin? How many know that in, amen, praise God, that he, in due time, when we were yet without strength, he what? He died for the ungodly. So let's bow our heads to today. And let's, hallelujah, begin to think about that person that's at the brink of disaster, that's at the brink of hell. Person that we've never said anything to. We've never encouraged them. We've never sounded the alarm. We've never told them the destiny that they face and that awaits them. I want you to think about those souls today. And I want you to make up in your mind that you will not let another week pass without you reaching out. Not even a day pass without praying. Without asking God to really begin to touch the lives of those who have never heard. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus said, I am come that you might have what? Life. Amen. God wants everybody. The Bible says he has no pleasure in the soul that died. Soul that perished. He has no soul, no pleasure in the person that's lost. But he wants that person saved, and he wants them to come to the knowledge of the truth. Amen. How many believe that God is willing and ready to save? He's ready to turn your life around. He's willing to forgive and to blot out every transgression. And he completely eradicate whatever record that you have established in unrighteousness. God wants to do that, and he wants to do it today. I want everybody to stand on your feet. Let's begin to pray and to